My love is like a red, red rose that's newly sprung in June. My love is like a melody so sweetly played in tune. Fair art thou, my bonnie lad. How deep in love am I, and I will love thee still, my dear, till all the sea's gone dry. Till all the seas run dry, my dear, and the rocks melt with the sun. I will love you, I love you still, my dear, while sands of life shall run. So fare thee well, my only love, fare thee well, and I will come again, my dear. Though it were 10,000 miles. My love is like a red, red rose that's newly sprung in June. My love is like a melody so sweetly played in tune. And fair art thou, my bonnie lad, how deep in love am I, and I will love thee still, my dear, till all the seas run dry.
Wow, what a way to begin. Welcome, everyone. Welcome to the Myth Salon today. I'm really struck by when we begin, we launch into an entire journey. We are particularly in a troubled environment right now with this fire in Lahaina, Maui. And I was telling Kayleen as we were warming up, it's hard not for me to think about the Loggins and Messina song of Lahaina. And I urge you sometime later tonight or in the next day or two, go to YouTube and look at the video that's put against that song, which is really a time travel type song anyway. It'll show you what we lost. I mean, it brings tears to my eyes. You'll see the bars and the people walking along the streets and the harbor. And my brother lives in Kihei, which is outside Lahaina. It's all gone. It's all gone. So, what I'd like to do is let's have a moment of silence before we really begin, and then I'll do my best to introduce everybody, and let's be quiet for a second. I'd like to open today's Myth Salon with a poem by David White. He has his heart in the right place. And this is a poem called Tobar Padrag. Turn sideways into the light, as they say the old ones did, and disappear into the originality of it all. Be patient with easy explanations, and teach that part of the mind that wants to know everything, not to begin questions it cannot answer. Walk the green road above the bay, and the low, glinting fields toward the evening sun. Let that Atlantic gleam be ahead of you, and the gray light of the bay behind you, until you catch, down on your left, the break in the wall. For just above, in the shadows, you'll find it hidden, a curved arm of rock holding the water close to the mountain, a just-lit surface smoothing a scattering of coins, and in the niche above, notes to the dead and supplications for those who still live. But for now, you are alone with the transfiguration, and ask no healing for your own, but look down, as if looking through time, as if through a rent veil. From the other side of the question you've refused to ask. And you remember now that clear stream of generosity from which you drank. How, as a child, your arms could rise and your palms turn out to take the blessing of the world. So, Kayleen, let me turn it over to you.
Thank you, Dana.
Why don't you say something for us, Kayleen, and take us on a journey?
Okay. Thank you, Dana. And when Dana asked me if I would return to the Myth Salon to talk, I was in the midst of preparing for Scotland. And I had no idea, of course, a few weeks ago about the events that would unfold in Hawaii. And yet I feel like the story that I'm going to weave tonight with the help of my beloved friends, Robin O'Brien, whose voice you heard singing us into the salon, and the poets, Kim Rosen and Keiko O'Leary, and my beloved friend, the artist, Sue Ellen Parkinson, really will weave together strands that is, in fact, I hope, a journey of hope for all of us. And it shows what's possible when a poem, a little tiny poem, can be buried in the hearts of those who hear it, and how for generations and generations to come, that little tiny poem can sow the possibility of renewal, regeneration, creativity, and healing. And I just want to return to a few of the lines from the poem that you read, Dana, and then we're going to weave this tapestry together with music. But in that poem by David White, I'm going to just show my screen. And he speaks about drinking from the clear stream of generosity, and also of looking through time. And as he was writing this particular poem, he was also referencing legends of the Celtic tradition of those who turned sideways into the light and then disappeared. And this goes back to some of the stories that sprouted, like just the beautiful image in botany that sometimes something will be cut to the ground. And then in another season, it will spring up again when it's least expected. We're going to see how myth became the catalyst for this. renewal in Scotland during two successive waves of complete and utter devastation. But to really begin this, I just have invited Robin to sing a verse of the Skyboat Song. I know that many of the Miss Salon participants and audience are fans of movies and television. And this is a very oft recorded song, but it's the theme song for Outlander. And as you listen to this, I just invite you to be carried on a boat of memory. The lyrics have changed many, many times over 200 years. And it'll be a surprise to me which ones Robin's going to sing tonight, but she's going to sing some. And I want to invite you to imagine as you're listening, maybe you even want to get out your pen tonight, because part of what we're going to celebrate is this Celtic experience in principle of the interwoven nature of relationships. And in the particular, in the Scottish Renaissance, this absolute revolt against separating and cutting things out, you know, as our friend T.S. Eliot would have said, you know, how can I begin when I'm pinned against the wall? And the part of what we're going to celebrate about this Celtic Renaissance is the people who came together to say no more divisions. Let's have science inspire art. Let's have art inspire music. Let's have music inspire community organizing and town hall planning. And it will all be braided together. So Robin, carry us with your voice, your beautiful voice. And with your pens, as you listen to her, just see what comes. Draw, write words, see if images come. Maybe you'll want to put them in the chat box. But what get stirred in you.
Speed, bonny boat, like a bird on the wing, onward the sailors cry. Carry the lad, born to be king, over the sea to sky. Give me again all that was there, give me the sun that shone. Give me the eyes, give me the soul, give me the one who's gone. Sing me a song of a lass that is gone, say could that lass be I. Merry of soul, she sailed on a day over the sea to sky.
Thank you, Robin. So that line of sing me a song of what is gone is the launching point for our journey together. Because so much of these two waves of the what we call the Celtic revival, the Celtic renewal, and the Celtic Renaissance in Scotland comes in a time of devastating and utterly devastating loss, a time in which the Scots were completely suppressed and their culture was in it threatened with being erased. A time of the clearances of the Highlands, when people who had known one way of life for centuries were ripped off of their islands, and some of them forced to board boats for the United States and Canada. And it was in this time then that there began to be stirring this longing in the midst of industrial revolution, a longing to connect to nature. These coincided, and we're going to see that the Romantic movement, many historians think, can be traced back, like Ariadne's thread. If you trace it all the way back, you'll find at its heart this effort to recapture an ancient Celtic way. Just, I've put on the image on the right, a pilgrim's cross made from the wild goose community in Iona Abbey. And notice that above the faces of the pilgrims, you have that interlacer cross of things woven together. And part of what was in the Celtic way of things, particularly in Iona, was a sense that nature and art, music, poetry, and friendship were all passageways to the divine. And that this spoke then of a time in which we weren't so fragmented, in which you didn't have to choose between science and spirituality, time in which you didn't have to choose between art or literature. They were braided together as a holy pathway. So this longing to reclaim some of the Celtic ways of things was woven in time and time and time again, and particularly the island of Iona and the islands and the highlands of Scotland. And so into this realm in the 18th century, James McPherson came, and he was a school teacher, a school teacher who was going through the highlands and the islands. And while he was there, he was watching and listening to the decimation of his culture that was being completely supplanted, that the language that had been cherished and spoken, the Gaelic tongue and the tradition of oral tales told by the campfire and songs sung at night and by the seashore, that way of life was being eradicated brutally. And it was at this time that he began to collect together what he first called fragments of ancient poetry. And he claimed, he came back and he claimed that he had found this bard, these bard tales. And it was this blind bard named Ossian who would sing his songs of lamentation for what was long past and what was long gone. And this was published, and this could be, and has been, whole lectures. But this book, well, it's spread like wildflowers or like wildfire all throughout Europe. And it was translated into Danish and into Russian. And this book of the blind bard singing his songs of lamentation for fallen heroes, for lost love, and for a lost way of life that goes back to pre-Christian origins. Those poems ignited the imagination of all of Europe and the artistry. Here are just a few of the paintings. This one by the French painter Ang, that was, you can see his dream of the supernatural realm as he puts his head on his harp in deep sorrow and lamentation. And these lamentations of tragedy, oh, they just sparked such a renewal of the imagination, not just in Scotland, not just in the British Isles, but all over. In fact, Thomas Jefferson loved these books of poetry so much that he said that he wanted to learn to read them in the original Gaelic. Napoleon Bonaparte carried them into war with him and had images painted on his chambers. And Goethe quoted at length in two of his novels. So many people think that the German Goethe was the origin of the Romantic movement. Well, maybe so in Germany, but he was resting on the shoulders of James McPherson, who said that he had found these works that dated back somewhere in the mists of time. Now, it turned out that that was a lie, that he actually was, yes, taking some stories with ancient origins that eventually the Irish said, no, 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 they're not Scottish, they're Irish. But they claimed these stories of these lost heroes and these blind bards and these characters like Fingal. And this fabrication of a story around that people were trumpeting, that the Gaelic bard Ossian was Homer's equivalent, inspired so much music. It inspired Scottish folk songs by Beethoven and Schubert and songs of Ossian by those two, as well as Mendelssohn and Brahms and Massenet. And the image that you see before you, some of you will know, is, well, some of you know it from J.K. Rowling, because it's where some of the Horcruxes were found. But actually, in an earlier incarnation, this was the Cave of Fingal. And it's why the young composer Felix Mendelssohn went at the age of 20 from Germany to go hike and tromp through the Scottish Highlands to the islands, because he wanted to see the cave. He wanted to see the cave of this character. And you can see his own art that he created on either side of him. But it didn't just inspire art and literature and music. It also inspired nature. There was a duke, the Duke of Athol, who had been listening to these stories of these wild woods and these forests. And oh, he longed to return to those days. This forest actually is a forest made famous by Shakespeare as Birnam Wood and Macbeth, for when Birnam Wood is cut and comes to Dunsinane, well, that forest had been decimated. But as the Duke of Athol read these stories and imagined the wild woods, oh, Well, he set his botanists out to America to bring back seedlings, including what we know now as the Douglas fir. And he put these seeds and he shot them out of cannons all throughout Perthshire. And he planted over 21 million trees, 21 million trees, as a way of recapturing the wildness of what had been lost. On the left, you see the image of the waterfall. But in the middle, he also wanted to build a little hermit's hut to evoke this blind bard Ossian. And he got so far as to start auditioning blind harpists to play there so that when visitors came to the forest, they would hear Ossian's lamentations being said and being sung. And there you can see on the right, the cave there. And this is where Felix Mendelssohn went and was inspired to create his Scottish symphony. So I hope you can already feel bubbling inside of you. I mean, I'm feeling bubbling inside of me. The seeds of inspiration, like how all of this starts to foment as something that invites and invokes the epic imagination. And these were the tales then that Sir Walter Scott and Robert Burns were fed on, the poems of Ossian. And they gave them a glimpse to a further horizon that it would be possible. It would be possible to take in some of the brogue of their native tongue and to give voice then to the wilds and to the wild rose and the red, red rose and the tales of the Celtic past and the history of Scotland. And it empowered them. And that's part of what I want to talk about is that creativity can be contagious. Creativity can be contagious, and it can invite us to claim the little tiny seed that's in us and see how wild it can grow. And that's exactly what happened. And one of the things I just love about Scotland is that the biggest building in Edinburgh is not for a bank. It's not even for a church, and it's not a government building. The biggest building in Edinburgh is a monument to a poet. It is Sir Walter Scott's monument that you see right there, surrounded by the gardens. And everywhere you go in that capital city, there is a poetry path to follow. Literally, the stones that you walk in are inscribed with poems. Literally, the stones outside the Scottish Parliament have quotes about nature and quotes about poetry. And many think that that all can be traced back to that singular seed. The lie that told the truth, that poems of lamentation are what we are all aching for across the centuries. And that medieval imagination so infected Sir Walter Scott that you can see that he created this extraordinary manor house that's filled with, I think it's 14,000 volumes of poetry, including Dante, but all kinds of works, including, of course, Ossian. And he went beyond that. He decided that he would take medieval images from abbeys, one on the left, from Melrose, the one on the right, a casting from Iona of a Sheila na Gig from Ireland, and that those images would also feed and fuel his imagination. Well, all of that in the 18th century became the mother's milk for the next figure in our tale. And that is Sir Patrick Geddes, who was known first and foremost as a botanist. Charles Darwin wrote that he had the intellectual capacity that any university would be proud to hire him. And he was so fascinated by the natural world, but he was also fed on the tales of Ossian. And for him, there didn't need to be a conflict the way there was for so many people in ages of specialization, because his own wild thinking, his own wild dreaming went back to that Celtic world of the Druids, in which there were Druids who were scientists and healers, but who studied nature and who came together for their government meetings and their town councils and circles of sacred groves. And they began with rituals of sacred intention, but that their songs and the history was sung by bardic tales, so that all of this, like those interlacer patterns, could come together. Now, he's not a household name these days, but the phrase that he coined certainly is, because he's the one who said, think global, act local. He was an urban town planner. He adored the arts. He adored music. And his principles went back to what his romantic imaginings of a Celtic world, a Celtic dream world, were like. That the world would be run by collaboration, not competition. That there would be a conversation across disciplines. That you would go deep into your ancestral past to find inspiration for the future. That there would be circular rather than hierarchical models of leadership. That there would be no rigid division between society, that students and teachers would have common cause together, and that the ordinary would be revered as sacred, that everyday objects, just like a brooch, just like a book, would be as harmonious and lovely as what we have come to think of as high art. And above all, he had the principle that beauty would be balm to heal us, and that nature and public art should be at the center of the city, that there should be free museums and free gardens for everybody. And that he encouraged both side by side, not in contrast, not in conflict, but together, braided together, the mythopoetic imagination and scientific study. So I love the story of how, as a botany professor, he would teach. His classes were completely jam-packed. There were standing room only, but he would begin with a leaf. I should have had one as a prop tonight, but he would take, for example, an oak leaf or a sycamore leaf, and he would say, "Let us consider this leaf." And first he would describe it and have everybody look at it. What were the physical characteristics? How many different veins were there? How was it? How many petals if it were a flower? What was it looked like? How could we look at it from a scientific perspective? But then he would trace it back and he would say, what did the ancient Celts say about this? What were the Druid lores of this? What were the songs that were sung about oak or rowan tree? What were the tales? What are the myths that we could tell? And he would enchant everybody with that. And then after he got their imaginations completely fired up, they would go and they would sit in the gardens. And now he would say, what is alive in you? What is alive in you? And he would send them out and the scientists would be alive doing their scientific work. But the artists who came in would be inspired to take those stories of the oak tree and the sycamore tree or the plants that they were studying and to weave them into their paintings with a new attention to scientific realism. Now, he was hired to be an urban planner in Edinburgh at a time that was catastrophic. There was disease run rampant. And there were some horrifying statistics. I mean, I think it was like one out of every 10 children were dying in Edinburgh because of the horrific sanitation circumstances there. And one of the things that he realized that was causing this was the stratification, that the wealthy lived in the new town and the poor lived in the old town, and the students were sequestered by the university, and there was this division amongst society. And he didn't think that that could be any better for the human environment than if we have monocrops, if that is for the environmental environment. So he designed this. What you see before you is called Ramsay Gardens. And he and his wealthy wife, who had been an heiress, bought a home in the middle of what was regarded as a slum. Because he said, only by connecting with the people and knowing the situation from the inside can we have any idea what their lives are like. So he built these beautiful buildings that you see before you. You can actually go in, and these days you can rent one on Airbnb through Edinburgh. And he had this new idea that this would be the hub of student life, and that he would want, very close to what had been a slum, he would want the urban renewal to be focused on two things, on nature, well, three things, nature and art as a vehicle for creating community. So there were public gardens where the students would work, where they would study botany and farming practices, but the public gardens also produced fruit and vegetables that the local residents could come and have when they were hungry. and that the walls and the passageway he hired artists to paint, and the things that he painted on the walls, where we could imagine these days graffiti would be, but on the walls he painted these incredible murals of Celtic paths, of heroes of history, but also legendary heroes. And he wove them together. And it started to transform society. He had over 75 gardens planned for this one city, and he was able to establish 10 of them. And it became a model for throughout the world. Later, he was hired in India and by Tel Aviv in governments there to redesign cities with gardens and history at the heart. And one of the murals that he created, then you can see how these two things could be in harmony. Music as a principle for harmony, that you can have different parts going together and it can yield something more beautiful than a singular line. So here you have a great figure from the mythic past here, crowned with laurel leaves, playing on panpipes, right next to Charles Darwin. So Charles Darwin is here listening to the lure of the panpipes. And behind him, you see foliage that is rendered in exquisite detail, in botanic detail, so that you could actually classify the plants. One of his great collaborators that we're going to talk about a little bit more in just a moment is John Duncan. And as part of it, this is the image that John Duncan created to evoke those legends of the Tuath De Danann that David White was referring to in his opening poem. So this is that figure, those figures of the mythic past, surrounded though by nature, by birds, by butterflies, by all kinds of nature, with intense fidelity to the scene of the islands. Here's another image from the Ulster cycle, that the warrior queen of Scotland, so that the heroes and the heroines, and boy, there was an emphasis on equality of men and women in the circle of Patrick Geddes. Empowerment of women was so important. And so this was inscribed on the walls for the students as well. And he would take them then to what had just been born in Edinburgh, the Museum of Science and Art. And here they would study, what had been emerging from archaeological excavations of Celtic arts carved on stone across the centuries. And this would inform the imagination of the artists who were hired to do illuminated manuscripts of the poets. But they would also study this science, and he became friends with this man, Ramsay Traquair, who was the newly installed director of this Museum of Science. Now, he himself was a paleontologist, and he specialized in ichthyology and fish, but he had moved to Edinburgh with his wife, Phoebe. Phoebe, who had done the illustrations of his scientific journals and now was a mother with young children. I get a little teary, actually, with the story sometimes, so forgive me if I cry. But while she was here at home raising the children, her husband was very traditional, but Patrick Geddes was not. And he saw Phoebe's amazing capacity for art, and he said, "I have a job for you. Would you please come and work for me?" Because there had been a hospital known as the Royal Hospital for Sick Children. And as I said, during this time of cholera and epidemics, because of horrific sanitary conditions, one out of every children was dying. And as the children were dying, there was a room that he wanted. Oh, I really get... He wanted the families who are going to see the bodies of their dead children to be surrounded by images that would bring them love and comfort. He didn't want there to be a sterile environment where they would see the little body of the child covered with a sheet. He wanted them to have images that would seep into their souls to console them. So they were given a coal room. And this is what Phoebe created. She began by creating the images from nature of the sea serpents and the snakes and the fish that she had been doing for her husband and the dove, but she had put inscribed on the walls images from poems And then she had images here of a mother holding her baby surrounding by angels. And there was religious terminology drawn from the Psalms to console those who were religious. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. But there were also images from poetry that were there. And it was here that they had little beds and they would tenderly dress the children and they would surround them by wildflowers that had been gathered from the gardens. And so these were the images that the parents would see, knowing that they were not alone. It would give them comfort with this idea that their children would be carried up by angels. Phoebe did this without a dollar of pay. It was from the labor of love that was the Edinburgh Union, this question at the heart, how can we use art and nature? How can we use art and nature to meet the suffering of the world around us? He encouraged Phoebe to explore all the ways that she could to take her artistry and make things sacred, to bring not a division between the church and the daily work and the daily labor. So this is a tapestry that she did. The stitching on this is absolutely unbelievable. It hangs now in Edinburgh's museum, and it draws its story from Edmund Spenser's Faerie King, going back into the mythic past. But this one was from Walter Pater's great book of philosophy about the progress of a soul. Again, a tapestry that goes from innocence to despair in the middle, and then to a sense of transcendence in the far right. She also made chalices. A chalice we think of as being an object for religious use, but her chalice was emblazoned with the story of Psyche and Eros in its enamel. And she made jewelry. And she painted poetry and images of mythology and Dante Gabriel Rossetti on pianos and harpsichords. Unbelievable the way that she drew together nature, mythology, and art. Her greatest work, though, it's just been opened again a few years ago, called the Mansfield Traquair Chapel. And again, in this spirit, this Celtic spirit, that science and spirituality can coexist, that art and nature are harmonious, she created what is often referred to these days as Edinburgh's Sistine Chapel. Single-handedly, she lay on a scaffold for 8 years and painted. But there's no image of crucifixion here. There are only images of celebration, with nature drawn from the Scottish Highlands and the islands, images of celebration in which everyone would be welcomed in a love story. It is extraordinary. This is an image where righteousness and peace have met each other, where truth and justice kiss one another, but it could also be where science and spirituality and art find their harmony. I love that there's the Celtic harp and the warrior's dagger. And this also evokes this theme of that in the ancient Celtic past, the kings of Scotland were crowned sitting on what was known as the Stone of Destiny. And they were seen as having to wed together nature, their love for the land, as well as their love for the people. The two must be one. The two must be one. So one of the things that Phoebe said about to an artist or a poet, painter, or a musician, the world is a great treasure house stored with endless material to use. Teach yourself to match the beauty of red-lipped buds and sunlight through green leaves, the yellow gorse on the hill and the song of the wild birds, on and on. For this is life. This is life. The perfection comes when your own life is in harmony with this beauty. So she didn't see any contradiction between taking a form of the illuminated manuscript associated with sacred Bibles and using them for the poetry of a pre-Raphaelite Dante Gabriel Rossetti. Gorgeous works, inspired by the Book of Kells. And the Book of Kells, which is now in Dublin, which is where Phoebe had grown up and she had gone, oh, all as often as she could to go and stare at its pages, and it infused her imagination with possibilities. But that Book of Kells is ascribed to having been created in Iona, a community founded in the 6th century by St. Columba. And here there was then, began to be these revivals of these tall stone crosses with the interlacer pattern. And that image of Iona, Iona, Iona haunted the imagination of Patrick Geddes still. And he wanted to find a way then to draw together everything that was being born in his time. And he created a quarterly journey called The Evergreen, a journey of art, poetry, fairy tales, science articles, mythology, history, and ecology. He called it a resource for and perhaps even a manifesto of cultural evolution. And so it was published on the Celtic cross quarter days, and it looked at everything in the world around from both the literal and symbolic lens. And part of this community also began to republish those poems of Ossian and inspired the art that you see in collaboration, not competition. So the Druids bringing in the mistletoe is a collaborative artwork by two artists in Glasgow inspired by Geddes' work. And the images that you see here, the graphic design on the chapter called The Biology of Autumn, was done by John Duncan, the one who had done the murals for Ramsay Gardens. And he went off to Iona, and he learned about the legends of St. Columba bidding farewell to his horse. And so he painted the stories of this 6th century Celtic state. And while he was Iona, he painted the beautiful landscapes. And oh, friends, oh, the sunsets, the sunrises are so exquisite here. And the stars are clearer on a clear night than I have ever seen anywhere. But he also explored the pre-Christian legends about Iona, like the story of the Kayleak, who's also known as the winter hag, who is the old woman who causes winter to come and who travels throughout the year. During the winter time, she goes to the highlands, but round about St. Bridget's Day, she goes to the well that you see on the right. That is the fountain of eternal youth. And she bathes her face and she becomes St. Bride again, the young maiden who over the course of the year, at the turning of the tide, grows older and older. So he turned to these stories and he found no contradiction. This is probably his most famous painting, certainly his most beloved at the National Gallery, in which you see the story of Saint Bride, the pre-Christian goddess of the islands and the highlands. And she is being carried, according to the Celtic legend here, by the angels. In this story, Saint Bride, and in fact, the Hebrides mean islands of Bride, and they were sacred to the Druids long before Saint Columba and the missionaries arrived. But in this, Saint Bride is being carried by the angels, and she's being carried to Bethlehem, where she's going to become the midwife to the baby Jesus for Mary's birth. So here's this legendary story, but I'm going to call your attention to a couple of details. First, notice all the wonderful patterning on the framework of this, which draws its inspiration directly from pre-Christian Celtic stone carvings. But then also look at the role of the animals, the legendary Selkie, and then the seagulls. And then on the robe itself are all the details and the stories of the life of Jesus, including the Last Supper and the crucifixion and the resurrection. But in the central panel, you'll see the three magi. No contradiction in this world, the Celtic braid that could hold both pagan myth and Christian story and weave them together in a work of beauty that celebrated nature. And we see this in his artwork again and again with the Celtic braiding and Tristan Isolde, again inspired by the Book of Kells. And so John Duncan went here to Iona to drink in the legends and the story and the imagery, but he also brought his good friend Marjorie Fraser Kennedy, who went with him. And they would go knock on the door, knock, 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 knock. And they would say, do you have a song that you can sing me from the islands? And Marjorie, with her perfect pitch, would transcribe it all and write it down, and there would be the songs from the islands and the highlands. And our dear Robin O'Brien is going to sing us one of the stories from the Celtic legends here that was taken and transcribed and reimagined.
This song is called Beloved Gregor, and when I found it, I realized it was a sad song about standing at the graveside, and I didn't want to have a sad song. I wanted a lullaby, and I think the freedom of these kinds of songs that are so essential is that they allow you, folk music changes, it changes, so you get to have your own story. So I have a different story for Beloved Gregor. And if you want to sing the chorus with me, please do. I'll sing it two or three times. It was early on Lammas Day. I lay with my love until the sunlight golden crowned us at noon. Through many nights of cold and rainy weather, in seven elements of star, Gregor would tuck me safe in a corner where I could shelter warm. Oban, oban, oban iri, oban iri, oban, oban, oban iri, slumber in peace, my love. The ripened apples on our tree blossomed red from green, with a spice and fragrance so sweet, and hanging low to my reach. If I should lose you in the mist, and I will lose you surely, I know one day you will remember me and travel a long road home. Oban, oban, oban iri, oban iri. Oban, oban, oban iri, slumber in peace, my love. Oban, oban, oban iri, oban iri. Slumber in peace, my love.
So this place, I asked Robin to start researching and learning these songs to accompany me on a journey from Edinburgh to Iona, leading a pilgrimage last year. And we wove this together then, folk songs and stories and legends and myths with Felix Mendelssohn's journey and Phoebeanna Traquair's chapel and arriving on Iona, which really is one of those, they call it a thin place between worlds. They called it that in its Druid times, and they call it that in its Christian times as well. And it's really the natural beauty of this island is breathtaking to behold. And so Robin and I climbed up to the water of eternal youth. It was a very cold and windy day. You can see the wind blowing the waves on the water of Bridget's Well right there. And there's Robin, her hair caught by the wind. And when we came down, I told the story about this to Sue Ellen Parkinson, who was with us, my beloved friend and artist, who is such a fountain of creativity and who's someone I'm so blessed to be working with for the past 5 years. I'll be researching a story or a myth. This started with Mary Magdalene, where I said, "We don't have any images of this. We need these images. Could you paint this?" And she's painted so many, but she's also worked with me on different stories and legends, like of Yeshe Shogal, the Tibetan Buddhist teacher. And then she has a special devotion to Bridget. So I'm going to let her tell the story of Bridget and how she found the seeds of inspiration for her painting, and particularly the one about the Kayleak and Bridget meeting each other. So, Sue Ellen.
Thank you, Kayleen.
This is the one that we're going to talk about tonight. Let me just show them one more time so you can drink them in. A patron saint of all these things: poets, milkmaids, midwives, newborns, blacksmiths, fugitives, beer brewers.
And more. When I was looking up what she is the patron saint of, I mean, the list just did not stop. I didn't include everything on there. I mean, she's also the patron saint of nuns and boats, and it just goes on and on. The Irish people, the Scottish people, they have incredible faith in Bridget to do just about anything and take care of any problem, because I love poetry so much. And what I got from, I always get a certain feeling from working with any of these archetypes. And what I've gotten from Bridget is joy and playfulness. And I remember years ago talking to the environmentalist John Seed, who's a rainforest activist. And I said, how do we talk to people about these problems, these really heavy problems that we're facing right now, so that they can listen and hear it and take it into their lives and get activated? And he said, well, we need to do it with joy. And that's what I find with Bridget. She's teaching us how to tackle the world's problems with joy. So this was, they say that Bridget, they give her so many fantastical qualities, because the Saint Bridget is kind of morphed with the goddess Bridget, which is just fine with me. And apparently the Celtic imagination has no problems with it either. One of the things Bridget does is she dreams spring into being. And I think that this is a quality we all need to cultivate in ourselves, the ability to dream a blooming, flourishing world into being, especially right now, not in a airy-fairy way. You know, we do need to roll our shirt sleeves up and get to work, but we also have to really incorporate this feeling of joy and beauty in our lives, or we're just not going to get through these hard times that we're in. So this is the story that Kayleen told me on Iona that so moved me, the story of the Kayleak, the old crone. She's known as the Queen of Winter. And she ascends the mountain there on Iona, you know, pounding her walking stick all the way. I am 71 now, and I have a walking stick too, so I know what that's like. And as she goes up the mountain, the pounding of her stick creates the thunder and the lightning and the rain of winter. And then she reaches the top and drinks from Bridget's well, the well of life and renewal. And she transforms into Bridget, who then starts the cycle of spring again and brings all the little flowers and the newborn babies and all the sprouting new things into life. And did you include that other one, the detail, Kayleen? So what I really wanted to do in this painting was, even though it's actually about one person transforming back into her
her youthful self, you know, the youth, the full cycle. I wanted to show both aspects, the youth and the elder, honoring and loving one another. Because we're both, you know, we're both of equal value. We're both important to the cycle of life. And in this culture where I'm living in the United States, the emphasis is always put on youth. But in this one, the youth is honoring the elder and the elder is honoring and blessing the youth. They're both equals in this beautiful, mysterious world, this life we live in. So it's a teaching story that helps us embrace our full humanity, I think. Thank you, Kayleen.
Thank you so much, Sue Ellen. And so both Robin and Sue Ellen exemplify this, what I'll call a Geddesian spirit about how creativity is contagious and how you connect to a story and the story gives birth to an image or a song, and that it just feeds each other. And it was such a joy to have you both with me on the pilgrimage to Scotland and to see all of in the year since then. It's almost exactly a year now since we went, and to see the different things that have sprung from that. And one of the things about Phoebe Anna Traquair, walking into that amazing chapel and seeing that, Sue Ellen, do you want to just say a word about what your experience as an artist was seeing this? Because she's one of these people that not even people that I've met in Edinburgh know about her. So I want the world to know about this amazing woman, because her art is just breathtaking, all the more so when you're actually there.
Well, it is stunning. It's beautiful. It was just breathtaking. But of course, as a woman artist, I couldn't help but relate to your story that you told, Kayleen, and the fact that she's like grabbing spare moments at the end of her day after taking care of what it was, a three children and a husband, and going up on these scaffolds and painting this incredible piece of work that was pretty much, it started to decay, didn't it? Or it was getting covered up, and then
they belonged to a church community, and the church community sort of disappeared because of lack of membership. So it became abandoned, and it was used for storage for decades. And then finally, just a few years ago, it was bought and began to be restored, and just was reopened shortly before the pandemic. And unfortunately, it's the sort of place that it's only open now for 4 hours a month. But I happened to be walking by and saw a glimpse of it when it was being used for a wedding, and it took my breath away. And I had to go back and find it and see it. So I arranged for a private tour when we did our pilgrimage. And there's a community now, an association dedicated to trying to save that, and also her chapel for the sick children, which is in danger of being destroyed as well. Mm-hmm. So, that kind of gets back to, I think, this larger thing about the lamentation about what's lost and what is our role collectively and individually in trying to save the things that need to be saved. How do we do that? But I'm going to use this as a moment to bridge to Keiko, because one of her friends was William Butler Yeats. When William Butler Yeats came to visit her, he came to see what she had created. And he said it was one of the most transcendent experiences of his life to walk into this chapel, that for him, the glory and the transmission, we could say, the transmission, Sue Ellen's nodding her head. Yeah, the transmission of what is in this chapel. There is no photograph I can show you that will do justice to what this building is. So if you ever get to Edinburgh, do everything you can to go see it. It is unbelievable. And he got that right away. And in some of her artwork, she actually paints his face. She painted in her pantheon of saints in the song school. It includes Darwin, but it also includes Dante Gabriel Rossetti and includes William Butler Yeats. So she was putting in the procession of saints, artists and poets as well. So with that note, I want to pass the red rose to my friend Keiko O'Leary. Keiko is so many things, but one of the things she is the poet laureate of Cupertino. She runs writing workshops. And the reason I had to have her on this program is that I know, and I hope she's going to tell us now a little bit about her own love relationship with Yeats and her own pilgrimage to go and recite his poem on his grave. To you, my friend.
Thank you, Kayleen. Hi, everybody. I'm so, I want to ask you to think to yourself, who is your artistic ancestor? So to me, I always think of my literary ancestors. Yeats is one of my literary ancestors, but also Ray Bradbury and Gene Roddenberry. As Kayleen has been talking about, and as we have seen through all of this weaving of different arts and sciences, you can have a scientific ancestor or, a visual arts ancestor. I always feel a longing to be part of something that goes on before me and will go on after me so that I can feel my place in a line. One of the ways that I have found my own place that took a really a long time and very difficult because I always feel like I don't belong or I don't deserve it. But through the work of experiencing other people's art, I have come to accept my place in this line. So I want to share this poem with you. I'm gonna recite it twice. And the first time you'll listen to it, and then I'll talk about it and my relationship with it. And then I'll recite it again so that you can deepen your own relationship with it. And it's also really important to remember what Auden says in his poem for Yeats: the words of a dead man are modified in the guts of the living. Don't worry so much about that. It just happens. This is the Song of Wandering Angus. I went out to the hazel wood because a fire was in my head, and cut and peeled a hazel wand, and hooked a berry to a thread. And when white moths were on the wing, and moth-like stars were flickering out, I dropped the berry in a stream and caught a little silver trout. When I had laid it on the floor, I went to blow the fire aflame, but something rustled on the floor, and someone called me by my name. It had become a glimmering girl with apple blossom in her hair, who called me by my name and ran and faded through the brightening air. Though I am old with wandering through hollow lands and hilly lands, I will find out where she has gone and kiss her lips and take her hands and walk among long dappled grass and pluck till time and times are done the silver apples of the moon, the golden apples of the sun. So that poem was published in 1899. And I feel it so alive to me as a sacred text of my personal religion. I've always, when people see my name, they often wonder if I'm half Japanese and half Irish. And I'm not. I'm 100% Keiko and 100% O'Leary. So last year, I finally had the opportunity to go to Ireland. And my great-grandfather came from Ireland. And I don't know if my grandfather ever went to Ireland, but I know my dad has not. So it's like coming back after generations is how I felt about it. And I went as an O'Leary. We went actually with 39 of my relatives and rode in a bus around Ireland for 10 days and went to my family's farm that my great grandfather helped save by sending money back. And that was a pilgrimage in itself. But I also went as a writer. And I also went to see, to visit Yeats' grave, because Yeats is my imaginary friend, as well as my literary ancestor. Kayleen asked me to mention that I, you know, talk with him and, you know, have a relationship with him through my imagination. It's really fun. You should try it. Just pick somebody who you'd like to talk with and you'd be surprised what they say. So when I went to Ireland, I don't have it. I have it in my phone. I have this picture in Schligach, or I think it's called Sligo in English. There's this building with his face painted on it, and also this poem, Song of Wandering Angus. I wrote something one time that said, if your work touches someone, your words will be painted on a building inside the town of their heart. So, you know, think to yourself what words are painted inside the town of your heart. And you might like to learn, if it's something that's short or just a part of it, you might like to learn it by heart so that it will always be with you. It's really a wonderful experience to have words that you have kept in your heart come to you at times when you need them. But my work, the thing that I want to say to you today, I work with writers mostly, but just with everybody, we all have a longing in our hearts for something that we want to create in the world. And I feel this poem is related to that. Even if you don't remember a moment when you dropped a berry in a stream, even if you feel like you never caught a little silver trout or that anything ever became a glimmering girl to you, maybe that stuff happened before you remember. There's something that you love. There's something that you want. There's longing that's within you and liking that's within you. And those things are not valued in our culture, but they should be valued by you. Because it's like this magical mystery of life, what we like and what we want. So just think to yourself as I say the poem again, you know, where's my stream? What are my silver apples of the moon? What are my golden apples of the sun?
You said this poem on his grave, didn't you?
I did. Oh, I forgot to say that. Sorry. Yes, we went. I wouldn't have done it either. My husband said, like, we were there, you know, with my kids in the, it's beautiful. There's woods there. The Connemara National Park is there. And I just like, oh, I don't know what to do. I came all this way, but, and my husband said, recite a poem. And this is the one that I chose. So if you want, you can imagine me at Yeats' grave, reciting this poem, Song of Wandering Angus. I went out to the hazel wood because a fire was in my head, and cut and peeled a hazel wand and hooked a berry to a thread. And when white moths were on the wing and moth-like stars were flickering out, I dropped the berry in a stream and caught a little silver trout. When I had laid it on the floor, I went to blow the fire aflame, but something rustled on the floor and someone called me by my name. It had become a glimmering girl with apple blossom in her hair, who called me by my name and ran and faded through the brightening air. Though I am old with wandering through hollow lands and hilly lands, I will find out where she has gone and kiss her lips and take her hands and walk among long dappled grass and pluck till time and times are done the silver apples of the moon, the golden apples of the sun. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Keiko. And one of the things Keiko is going to be doing soon is she has a program at a local library called Poetry in the Dark, where people come and recite poems in pitch dark. Doesn't that sound delicious? Love that.
Start one in your town. It's so wonderful.
And what you said about painting on every building, painting the poems on every building, oh, we just need to ignite our imaginations that way. What would it change? What would it change if in Patrick Geddes' spirit, you know, we were to go into the places that are most blighted by violence, that are most in need of beauty, and the walls would be covered with poetry and art. Ramsey Gardens was once considered a slum, and now it's the most beautiful place, and it's poetry, gardens, and art that did it. What could change? So Keiko, I don't think the two of you know each other, but you should, because Kim Rosen is next, and her wonderful book, Saved by a Poem, is something I recommend to everybody. And friends, her incredible album, Feast of Losses, when you are struggling. Actually, I would just say that, Dana, this would be a wonderful album to send to your brother, to anybody in Hawaii. I mean, there are certain things that I think should be in an emergency kit for despair. And one of them is Kim Rosen's Feast of Losses album. And the other one is All the Honey by Rosemary Matilda Trommer. Like, that should be there. But Kim is an amazing performer, poet, teacher. She takes people to Ireland and to Scotland as well. And anything you want to share about your own relationship to the Celtic world before you offer us your poem, I'm so happy to see you, friend.
Oh my gosh. Can you hear me well now? This is so rich. I you know, I signed up for this as a participant before you asked me to be a panelist because I am so, you know, I'm such a devotee of the Celtic path. Like many things in my life, I was drawn into it inadvertently. I had a friend through synchronicities, a wonderful woman named Chloe Goodchild, who's English. She teaches something called the Naked Voice. She's a wonderful human being. And she started requiring that her students study with me as part of their certification in terms of speaking poetry. And her students started creating workshops for me, and they created them in Ireland and in Wales and in Scotland. And it was through her students in that initial group, and that was back in 2006, and they drew out of me my mystery school. They called me into that. One of my dear friends really blessed me by saying, "You are reminding the bards of who they are." So as I would, you know, bring in through empowerment ceremonies the bardic levels of attainment, it always seemed to me so odd that there I was placing the mantle on the shoulders of these who have this Irish lineage. And my name is not yet Kim O'Rosen, but hopefully it will be soon. I just wanted to say something to Keiko. I love that poem so much. I remember reciting it with a wonderful singer named, I'm going to say her name wrong, Noreen Nirian, in the Limerick Art Museum. I learned there that the word for poet in Irish is singular is fila and plural is fili. And the word for poet and the word for mystic is the same word. Don't you love that? And that part of the initiatory process of becoming a phila is to sleep on the graves of your ancestors. And so as I thought of you reciting that poem, I thought of you standing on the grave of your poetic ancestor. Beautiful. I want to share a little secret about what I'm going to offer here. I wrote a book called Saved by a Poem, and one of the first chapters of that book is about my first relationship to being transformed by learning a poem by heart. The book is about the transformational power of becoming deeply intimate with poetry. It's not about writing poetry necessarily, although that may be an off-gas, but it's about the power of writing and speaking poetry as a self-transformation. And in that first chapter or second chapter, it talks about me learning E.E. Cummings' poem, Somewhere I Have Never Traveled Gladly Beyond. But actually, this is the first time I've said this to anyone, that is a lie. The first thing I learned by heart is what I'm about to recite, which is a passage from A Fairy Tale for Grown-Ups by the Irish novelist and poet James Stevens. And it's a passage from the great god Pan talking to the shepherd girl. And this is the passage that first saved my life. And it felt to my editor and me, it felt too complicated to explain. Well, this happens to be a prose piece, but this is a book about poetry. So we said that it was the second poem that I learned, which was in fact, Somewhere I Have Never Traveled. But I'm very happy to offer this passage from the fairy tale for grown-ups called A Crock of Gold by James Stevens. And I'm going to recite it with music by, and I'm sure I'm going to get this wrong, a beautiful Irish composer who I have met and performed with his sons. Actually, you probably know his sons. David White performs with his sons, whose name I can't remember right now.
Owen and Molly?
Yeah, yeah, exactly. But their father's name in English is Michael O'Sullivan, but it's much more beautiful in Irish. It's something like Michael O'Sullivan. And this is his music with the poem that I call a poem that is a prose piece by James Stevens. This is the great god Pan talking to the shepherd girl. I want you to forget right and wrong. I want you to be as happy as the flowers, as careless as the birds and the beasts. I want you to live to the depths of your soul as well as to the heights. Truly, there are stars in the heights, and they will be a garland for your forehead. But the depths are equal to the heights. Wondrous deep are the depths. Very fertile is the lowest deep. There are stars there also, brighter than those on high. The name of the heights is wisdom, and the name of the depths is love. How shall they come together and be fruitful? If you do not plunge deeply and fearlessly, wisdom is righteous and clean. Love is unclean and holy. I sing of the beast and of the descent, of the great unclean purging itself in the fire, in the thought which is not born in the measure or the ice, or the head, but in the feet and the hot blood and the pulse of fury. All things are seen in the light. How shall we value that which is easy to see? But the precious things which are hidden, they will be more precious for our search. They will be beautiful with our sorrow. They will be noble with our desire for them. The crown of life is not lodged in the sun. The wise gods have buried it deeply where the thoughtful will not find it. Nor the good, but the gay ones, the adventurous ones, the careless plungers, they will find it and bring it to the wise and astonish them. Come away with me, shepherd girl, through the fields, and we will be happy and careless, and we will leave thought to find us when it can, for that is the duty of thought. And it is more anxious to discover us than we are to be found. For that is the duty of thought. And it is more anxious to discover us than we are to be found. So Kaitlyn Ni Morahu arose and went with him, and she did not go because of love, nor because his words had been understood by her, but only because he was naked and unashamed. So I thank you, Kayleen, for inviting me to be part of this feast, and James Stevens and Michael O'Sullivan as well.
Thank you so much, Karen. Thank you. Oh, so the people that you've just heard are both my friends and also often my collaborators with something that I started called Mythica, and we do have something quarterly on the theme of poetry for a gratitude cafe, where you will hear these voices singing and reciting poems. And it would be, I think the world needs poetry as part of the triage for what we're facing right now. And I want to pass this now back to Dana to introduce our two other speakers to comment and share on their perspectives.
What a wonderful afternoon. I'm reminded how between the sounds of the words, there's a measure of silence. And when we structure the silence, meaning comes forth. And we hear in between the sounds that are outside, between the people who are singing, between the dogs that are barking, the horns that are honking, the rest of the cosmos. And it talks to us if we have the ears to listen. Two of my very good panelist friends are with me today. Maybe, Dennis, you would share a reflection and then even possibly share something that you might have written into this gathering. I think we really have allowed ourselves a rare treat this afternoon, and I really have Kayleen to thank for that. There's wonder in the world, and you brought it to us, so thank you. Dennis, you want to say something?
Yeah, thank you. You know, we all live by slogans. And one of my favorite slogans that seems to sustain me is risk-taking is myth-making. If we stop risking, something of our myth atrophies, becomes anemic, and loses its life force. So this is a poem entitled 22 February 2007. Thursday. Will today, I wonder, reading Borges be worthy of history? Will it, in other words, have such superior context and new rhythm to be worthy of recollection? What will be its tone, its angles of suspicion, when it hurries right out of the gate, surprised by its own momentum, heading out along the trampled field of the unexpected, along the backstretch of discovery, comes around fast to snap finally the plastic blue tape of an evening victory against the sun that refuses to set on time. Will history be, in quotes, made today? Or will it fade as yesterday dissolved before the tape was touched? If history does repeat itself, then today may find its mirrored face by noon. And so be only another day absent new smells, the same outdated milk in the fridge, no new inventions, or newly uncovered strange species to report on. Not even a burial site discovered under the streets, along the sewer lines, of some mythic king or princess, thought only a relic of an ancient story, too fabulous to be true, but real enough to be remembered. Thank you for giving me the opportunity.
Oh, thank you, Dennis. Thank you. I always feel in moments like this that sounds and words, they're sort of two sides of the same coin, and we can literalize them by attaching them to something, or we can just listen to them. And I'm wondering whether, like listening to the wind or listening to a musical instrument. I love the way that we've incorporated music into this. I'm wondering whether I can implore my good friend Jonas to pick up his shakuhachi flute.
Margaret and I returned from Scotland and Iona in June. I was so deeply touched, and that place that I was touched in my heart was enhanced tonight to hear Kayleen, Kim, Keiko, Robin, Sue Ellen, your words and your presence really comes through to awaken me, and I just feel really grateful that I'm here. I learned to play the shakuhachi about 30 years ago. I was in graduate school and in a Jesuit seminary, actually. I was interested in East-West dialogue, and I had done a lot of listening, but I thought of myself as a Christian. And I crossed boundaries my whole life since I was a juvenile delinquent as a child, pretty much let alone by my parents, so I could discover the world completely on my own. So here's the shakuhachi, and there's four holes and one in the back, and you blow across the top.
Thank you.
love with eternity. I say I love you to eternity almost every day. But I met Kim, I met Chloe Goodchild. I was playing shakuhachi in Belfast for a Buddhist Christian dialogue with the Dalai Lama and Father Lawrence Freeman. Does that ring a bell for you? Yeah? Yeah. Were you there?
I wasn't there, but I've heard the story many times because all the students that we both work with were singing with her at that time.
Oh, really? Yeah. There were about a dozen of us musicians because, I mean, this is a real inspiring piece story that the Dalai Lama and Father Lawrence Freeman, who's a Benedictine monk, came together in Belfast City Hall, and there were about 1,000 people, and they were both Protestants and Catholics. It was so touchy. There was not a dry eye in the place. And I was playing shakuhachi, and Chloe Goodchild was there. And we went into the studio and did some improv stuff together. And she's an amazing singer and inspiration. So thanks for reminding me.
Thank you, Jonas. Thank you, Kayleen. Thank you. Thank you very much. I want to say to Keiko, I have had that relationship with T.S. Eliot. And I actually had the lack of humility to write a series of poems called The Four Quartets that one of the stanzas in it says something like, prayer connects me with the unconnected, settling into the old chair of the moment, autumning my way from warmth to chill and wintering back a heartbeat. My soul's eye stirring the nothing from everything I have ever done or dreamt. Earthy tempest stretching roots deep, writhing in the cradle of connection. The eye embraced with sinuous twisting as if some magical calligrapher were shaping in the veins of nature images of power and love from deep water pockets of the rivers of the soul. That which is always has been, always will be, change, the dress of the dance, as the bird, the flower, my music in time reach for the fall of expression. So, Kayleen, you're like a river that I just want to come back to, you know? So let's go out with you. I'll come back after that and we'll do a singing bowl and send everybody home. But you really, really deliver.
Thank you, Dana. Well, what I would like to invite everybody to is to really take to heart that image of the Celtic braid. And so often in our world, we fragment, we separate. And I hope that what the story I've told tonight is an invitation to have deeper discussions across disciplines. You know, the idea that Geddes had of how can you possibly talk about urban planning without inviting in gardens? And if you have gardens, how can you not have poems? And if you have poems, how can you not have songs? And if you have songs, how can you not have art? That we're all interwoven and interconnected. And as a cultural historian, when I look back at the most prolific, exciting times, they always have that theme of crossing boundaries to invite the other in, to invite the other in. What happens if you get a biologist and an artist together in a Vienna salon with a Jewish hostess? Well, you get Gustav Klimt as the result. After looking through a little biology, you know, through a microscope, he sees the protozoa and he sees sperm and egg coming together. And that's what ignites his imagination to create his patterning. It's so important to have these discussions. It's so important whether you're talking about the Italian Renaissance or about right now, that those solutions that we are desperately hungry for our aching and healing world, they're going to need all of us to come together. But to return back to what Sue Ellen was evoking is like, how can we experience joy in the midst of suffering? How can we find our way there so that we don't lose the light of hope? And I think the things that bring us beauty are a well, a deep, deep well, to evoke one of the poems, that continues to offer us the water of life. So I just want to say a few things. Going to certain places can do it. Reading certain things can do it, but especially igniting your own creative spark. The past few years of COVID, I think the only thing that's been able to help me get through is if I make something. If I don't create something, I'm lost. And maybe your something is a symphony. Maybe it's a poem, but as some of the works that we talked about today, maybe it's stitching things together, or maybe it's just going to the beach, like this image here, and placing a stone and just saying the names of those you love, the names of your spiritual ancestors, and making a shape that can hold you. And if you're longing to find your own way back, if Scotland is beckoning to you and whispering to you, and if you feel like you want to stand in the Phoebe Anna Traquair Mansfield Chapel and see the art for yourself, or follow in the path of Andy Goldsworthy and Felix Mendelssohn and go to Iona, in a place where druids and bards and Christian saints and Macbeth all live harmoniously on one island. There is one room left for this year's journey, and we're about to open for next year's as well, and you might find the seeds for your own inspiration there. One of the things that fills my well with compassion and hope and beauty is joining with Sue Ellen and with Robin at a Buddhist retreat, Ratnaling. We'll be doing a retreat on Bridget's Day, and how to light the world with compassion, February 3rd through 5th. And then, as part of the way that I feel myself turning from despair to hope, from darkness to light, is every Sunday Robin sings in her amazing way, her voice, and we'll be gathering again this Sunday. So I invited her to close tonight's program before Dana does his final benediction by singing a Scottish folk song that seems more important now than ever. It's the words and Robin's voice with this melody that's been performed by Pete Seeger and James Taylor, but it was Robin's voice that came to me right in the aftermath of Hawaii. And it speaks to this sense that none of us can go across that river of despair by ourselves, that we really need each other to help us find our way across. So as another form of a ritual, I just invite you, while you're listening to Robin, in our conference services and a lot of the work I do, we talk about holding both hands full. And I just invite you to do this gesture if you can. Imagine in one hand the great suffering of the world, which is great and terrible indeed. Not just the people, but the trees, the animals, the very planet itself groaning. But in the other hand is love. And in the other hand is beauty. In the other hand are the things that you have seen today. Maybe you saw a few things on tonight's program, heard in Keiko and Kim and Robin's voices, something that brought the balm of compassion towards your shores. Looked outside my window and I saw a hummingbird, and the light is streaming golden now on the green leaves. So as Robin sings, I just invite you to imagine holding both of these hands full, going back and braiding them together. Yes, the suffering, but oh, the beauty. Yes, the sorrow, but oh, the love. And if you'd like to join us, 6 o'clock Sunday night in Sundance.
The water is white. I can't cross over. Neither have I the wings to fly. Bring me a boat that can carry two, and we'll both roam. My love and I, our love it shines clear against the storm, turns dark as night to bright as day, turbulent waters turn into calm, a blazing lamp to light our way. There is a ship that sails the sea. She's loaded deep as deep can be, but not as deep as the love I'm in. I know not how I sink or swim. The water is wide. I can't cross over. Neither have I the wings to fly. Bring me a boat that can carry two, and we'll both roam, my love and I.
The breath, the breath. So, Keiko, Jonas, Sue Ellen, Kim, Dennis, Robin, and Kayleen. What a beautiful, beautiful afternoon. You know, I don't normally close with a poem, but I would like to read a little bit of another David White poem called The House of Belonging. This last little bit says, "This is the day you realize how easily the thread is broken between this world and the next. And I found myself sitting up in this quiet pathway of light. The tawny, close-grained cedar burning round me like fire. And all the ranges and all the angels of this housely heaven, I love that. This housely heaven ascending through the first roof of light the sun has made. This is the bright home in which I live. This is where I ask my friends to come. This is where I want to love all the things it has taken me so long to learn to love. This is the temple of my adult aloneness. And I belong to that aloneness as I belong to my life. There is no house like the house of belonging." What a cool way with words he has. So let's listen to the singing bowl one more time, please. Beautiful afternoon. Thank you, everyone. Thank you. We had a wonderful attendance. Never quite had one like this, Kayleen. We've got to do this one again. Thank
Thanks
you all.
Thanks for inviting us.
Thank you.